A very good afternoon to all our viewers and welcome to a new edition of The World Today, where we bring you all the latest news from our website online from all around the world. I'm very delighted to be joined this afternoon in the studio by my guest here, Major General Mahmoud Morsi, strategic researcher at Chatham House, London. It's a very good afternoon to you, sir.
Thank you
very much for coming in this afternoon, and we have quite a lot of items. So let's start with news from home and Al Ahram Online. And the headline reads, Sahel-Saharan countries agree to form counter-terrorism unit with headquarters in Egypt. Now, the 27 Sahel-Saharan countries agreed on Friday after a two-day conference to form a terrorism combating unit with its headquarters in Egypt. The fifth Sahel-Saharan Defense Ministers Conference was held in Egypt's Red Sea Sharm el-Sheikh Resort in South Sinai. The decision to form a terrorism combat unit is among the 17 points that were announced in a conference declaration. The tasks of the unit have yet to be announced. Other points include forming joint patrols on borders of countries experiencing unrest to firmly combat the threat of terrorism and trans-border crimes. It also included an agreement on prohibiting all forms of political interference in the states, domestic affairs, and respecting sovereignty. On Thursday, President Abdel Fattah el-Sisi promised 1,000 scholarships for nationals of Sahel-Saharan countries in Egypt's military colleges. The conference, convening in Egypt, comes ahead of a summit of heads of member states of the community of the Sahel-Saharan States Organization to be held in Morocco later this year. Now, firstly, Major General Mahmoud, the importance of holding such a summit here in Egypt, in your opinion, especially during this current period of time?
Yeah, I think the decision to formulate the conference and getting in Egypt in this time, we are very late. We have to start it early, maybe 7-6 years, to stop a lot of things happening, like terrorist group and attacks in Libya and other countries, and in all the countries, Sahara, 27 countries, states. So I think the step now we have to just, we have to have strategic views and formulate these forces as soon as possible, just to protect security and defense is very important in Africa. And as you mentioned, the business season in the last few months, he have many meeting with African president in African Soviet Union, and he have agreed to cooperate in economic and on others in the political and many things in Egypt and with Africa. But it's very important. Security is defense, I think, is coming on the priority and the top of the agenda on Egypt and Africa.
Mm-hmm. Right. What are some of the most pressing issues on the agenda of such a conference, in your opinion?
As you read in the agenda, is we have the terrorist radical group and terrorist groups and the immigrations. These three most important things happen in Africa now. As you know, with the borders, Egypt have nine country borders, only states with other countries in Africa, and also in the Sahel Sahara, many countries have problems. So I think the first coming thing is the terrorist group and radical group. As you know, radical group in ISIS in Libya have been now established their bases in Libya and will be spread in many countries in Africa. So very important first to have a clear idea how and strategy to fight ISIS and radical group. Second one, the immigrations. The immigrations in Africa is very important, and they threaten to Europe. And the third one is a lot of other things, like human trafficking, weapons trafficking, many things we have to deal with in Egypt. So this is a very important subject.
Do you think forming a counter-terrorism unit with the headquarters based in Egypt is a positive step? Do you think it could allow, for example, for a new coalition to be formed in order to counter terrorism in not just Egypt, but the region as a whole?
I think the most important thing is the will of the states itself. First of all, we have to declare very strategic views. What is the objective? How the task forces will be formulated? How is the objective of these forces? And after that, we can together work to fight terrorism and defense security in Syria.
The collaboration between these different countries, with the President Abdel Fattah el-Sisi promised 1,000 scholarships for the nationals of Sahel-Saharan countries in Egypt's military colleges. How important, in your opinion, are such partnerships?
Yeah, this is very important because when, as a former military, when we cooperate with other nations, with other soldiers and officers working in over the world, we have to understand the doctrine and the strategic views and how is the armies and the armies working. So we have homecoming students coming with membership, scholarship here in military schools. This is very important because they understand how we're fighting, how we use our weapons, and we need to understand how they use their forces, how they understand the strategic and the military and the national security. When we coming together, we stand on one map, on one table, working together, and by the end of the day, we understand how we fight. And it is important going to the battlefield, we all of us understand what we're doing and understanding the enemy and the threat. Mm. So it's very important, very important.
Mm. It's a good collaboration.
Yes, of course, of course. Yeah.
And do you think we could learn as well? I mean, I know we are one of the most advanced armies in such a region, but the expertise, the exchange of expertise,
experience. Mm. When we're fighting, as you know, Egypt is fighting in desert, in desert area. Other countries is fighting in jungle area, another, you know, with another climate, with another ground, another terrain. Mm. This is under, we need to understand how is it working. Mm. So this is very important.
Yeah. Let's go to another item, the Gulf today, and the headline reads, maximum state of emergency declared in Tripoli. Now, authorities in control of Libya's capital on Friday declared a maximum state of emergency after a UN-backed unity government that they reject said its members would head to Tripoli to begin work. The city is under the control of an administration backed by armed groups, including militants, that is not internationally recognized. The head of the Tripoli authorities, Khalifa Houail, called on his interior and defense ministers and allied armed groups to take all security measures necessary to preserve the country's stability by increasing patrols and security checks. However, streets were calm on Friday morning, with police cars deployed at their usual positions around the cities, no signs of extra security measures. Of course, Libya has had two rival administrations since mid-2014 when an armed alliance overran the capital, setting up its own authority and causing the government backed by the internationally recognized parliament to flee east. The UN has been pushing for the two sides to cede power to a unity government under a power-sharing deal, but of course both have rejected the new authority headed by the prime minister. And the Tunisian-based presidential council headed by Sarraj, Faiza Sarraj, said this week that the unity government would start work in Tripoli, and the UN Special Envoy Martin Kobler was prevented from traveling to Tripoli to work on installing the power-sharing administration. Now, escalation of the situation in Libya, in your opinion, how dangerous is this?
It's very serious, serious. Mm. We have to fight in Libya to unite the post-government and have to fighting ISIS. I think the first important thing to unite all the parts, all the groups, to just working one under one flag. It's very important thing. I think the announcement of and the declaring of what happened in Tunisia 2 days ago with the foreign ministers coming together, and they said it's very important this two government coming one and united the government. First of all, there are a lot of many steps. As you know, now insert ISIS is have established very strong basis. They fighting to have ensure they have resources and way means to get oil from Libya, and they need to finance. As you know, the problems in Syria now will moving to Libya. If the neighbor state in around Libya didn't understand how it's important to get the united groups in Libya coming together and working together, we will facing serious problems.
Mm. Do you think that the international community has done enough to deal with the situation in Libya, or do you think there is room for a further serious effort?
Just looking at the ground, if they didn't enough in Libya, will be seeing a good results on the ground. Mm. But until now, the two governments is still working alone.
Mm-hmm. Now, you know, we know the amount of weaponry that has been smuggled into Egypt from the Libyan borders, and because of the instability in the country. What do you think Egypt can do to protect its own borders with Libya, plus assist them without interfering in their affairs?
Yeah, I think President Sisi said 4 days ago, he was very clear when he said, okay, we agree just not to interfere in Libya, because we need to understand if we have forces to enter Libya, which forces, what's the objective, what they are doing, and how other countries will support. This is very important. When we have these four objectives clear on the ground, we can enter Libya. This is one. The second one, we have to have all the powers in Libya coming together it is very important to support them instead of interfering in Libya. So I think we have now two gates to get in Libya. First of all, to support all the groups to come together and to fight, especially the military and the police. First, the second, in we are ready to interfere when it's important to interfere.
Right. Let's go to the World Bulletin. The headline reads, Palestinians welcome UN call for settlement database. Palestinian government has hailed the decision by the United Nations to establish a database of companies working in Israeli settlements. The United Nations Human Rights Council adopted four motions on the Palestinian territories, including one calling for the establishment of a list of companies operating from settlements in the Israeli-occupied West Bank. The UNHRC has also confirmed that Canadian Stanley Michael, as its new investigator on the situation of human rights in the Palestinian territories, also Israel-occupied further territories since the beginning of 2016. Over 450 Palestinian homes and other structures in the West Bank have been destroyed by the Israeli forces. Now, how do you view the United Nations call for a settlement database? Do you think that this will make a difference?
We try. I think United Nations needs to try, because United States already absent from solving any conflict between Israel and Palestinian. So United saying just to find a clear idea how things happen in between Israel and Palestinian. And statement in one of the problems, as you know, every day Palestinian is losing their terrain, their territory in the ground. And I think maybe in 3-4 years, when we were talking about 80% from the Palestinian terrain ground, just 10 years ago now, about 15% is the rest from this ground. Yeah. So I think by 3-4 years, Palestinians just to have only, maybe they have less than half of Gaza for them. Mm-hmm. So it's very important to solve these problems.
How do you think that the illegal settlements can be contained, in your opinion?
Yeah, I think first of all, the borders. Israel have to confess, to draw the borders on the ground. When we have borders on the ground, everyone will be stick to these borders. But Israel is very smart. They said, never we have borders. As you know, Israel have no constitutions. They didn't, because the constitutions would be have borders lines, the border on the ground. So the borders is very important. Drawing border on the ground is very important for both Israel and Palestinian. And I think Palestinians should be fight for have their border on the ground.
Mm-hmm. Right, let's go to The Guardian. The headline reads, Turkish officials say Europe wanted to export extremists to Syria. Now, Turkish officials have accused European governments of attempting to export their extremist problem to Syria, saying the EU has failed to secure its own borders or abide by pledges to share intelligence and cooperate in fighting the terrorism threat. The failures were outlined by Turkish officials to The Guardian through several documented instances of foreign fighters leaving Europe whilst traveling on passports, registered on Interpol watch lists, arriving from European airports with luggage containing weapons and ammunition, and being freed after being deported from Turkey despite warnings that they have links to foreign fighter networks. The conversations with Turkish officials took place before the latest Daesh claimed terror attacks in Brussels, but those bombings and the attacks in Paris last November brought into stark relief Europe's failings in tackling the threat from Europeans intent on traveling to Syria or Iraq to fight with Daesh and then return to carry out further atrocities at home. On Wednesday, the Turkish President Recep Tayyip Erdogan said Ibrahim el-Bakruni, one of the bombers at Brussels airport, had been detained in Gaziantep in June of last year over suspicions that he intended to travel to Syria as a foreign fighter. Though Belgian authorities were informed of his arrest, they told Turkey that they had no evidence that he had terrorism links and did not request his extradition. He was deported to the Netherlands before returning to Belgium. Ankara has also warned French authorities about Omar Ismail Mustafa, whose name turned up in an investigation of a cell of French nationals suspected of terrorism links that ran from late 2014 to the summer of 2015. How do you read Turkey's accusations for Europe and their lack of assistance and sharing of intelligence and them exporting terrorists?
Yesterday, I was sharing some experience with some friends with Wikistart. It's a very big organization working in intelligence and understand what is going on in Europe between Turkish and EU. And you, this is clear, this is true. Just there is a less and no cooperation between agencies, between the secret service, between intelligence organizations, just to deal with. And the Belgium accident is just showing up how is the weakness of this intelligence, because they understand after they having Salah Abdeslam, he's arrested, there's something happening in Belgium. And I say, and I think Turkish is right. Turkish have that didn't do a lot to understand what is intelligence is working between EU or between Belgium, between other country states and with Turkey. So I think this accident, maybe they understand they need to full cooperate in intelligence level between state to understand who is going on and who is traveling. And I think the network and the cell, the sleeping cell, the wolves in these countries are going to threat stability and security in Europe.
Mm-hmm. How do you describe the latest development with the terrorist attacks in Europe?
Yeah, I think this is have two parts. First one is to understand what the EU done to Syria and Iraq in the last years, the Western in all, what is doing to stop the threats and radical group in Syria and Iraq. And it one result is the threats and radical coming now to EU and Europe countries. The one thing, and the other thing, they didn't do a lot for refugees and the people is coming to. So she has both sides. I think is the result is the weakness attitude and don't understand the situation in the Middle East. So we need now to understand. Or maybe the EU, the Western and Europe need to have work and response to the crisis and just to try to solve the problem in the ground.
Mm-hmm. Do you think that more could be done by European countries to face not the problem in the region but on their own, in their own countries, really? Or do you think that there's a reluctance, a hiding of intelligence, not sharing enough information with other countries?
Exactly.
And what's the benefit of such actions? Do you think it's a denial that they have this problem, or do you think that they are still not used to the idea of terrorism in their own countries?
No, the problem is a lot of, we need to understand just a lot of radical groups, what's happening in Syria now, many of groups, they have problems between Daesh itself, inside Daesh they have problems because the finance and the resources, and they have not agreed because foreign fighters who come in to join ISIS have problems with the local area and with the habits of the traditional of the area, and a lot of them is moving through Turkish to Europe. Mm. This is one part. The second is sometimes Daesh is using these cells or these wolves to have doing something in Europe for their benefit. Mm. So we need to understand how is the relations between ISIS and these cells. This is one. Second, I think very important now for EU and Western countries to doing a lot for refugees, first one, and to help Syria to solve the problems.
Mm-hmm. Right, let's go to the Daily Star. Suicide bomber kills 30 at football game south of Baghdad. The item reads, a suicide bomber blew himself up in a crowd Friday after a local football game in a village south of Baghdad, killing at least 30 people. The village is near Iskandariya, a town about 40 kilometers south of the capital. Police captain said more than 65 were also wounded in the blast. The mayor of the town was amongst those killed in the explosion. There was no immediate claim taking responsibility for the blast, but mostly such attacks had been carried out by Daesh. Further south, at least 47 people were killed when a truck bomb exploded at a checkpoint at the entrance of the city of Hila on March the 6th. The attack was the deadliest car bomb explosion in Iraq this year. Situation in Iraq, further suicide bombers, further attacks on innocent civilians, and they're now moving to things like football games.
Yeah, as you know now, the problem is with the Mosul. ISIS is concentrated their effort in Mosul, and the army in Iraq have started to fighting in the new government to moving to Mosul. This is one part, and they need to support by the coalition forces, United States and Russia and others. This is one part, and the other part is Iraq itself has a problem. I think the Prime Minister yesterday, until now, he couldn't have formulated his new government because of the Kurdish and the Kurdish government refused to join this government. So the problem have two parts. First one, the government itself, the state itself, have many problems because a lot of parts, a lot of people is working in the, with different agenda. The second one is how to fighting in Mosul and Assad area in Iraq. Mm. Iraq now, maybe a lot of ISIS is moving from Syria to Iraq and on the other side, moving between these two states is very important to fight in Iraq. Mm-hmm. I think this kind of explosion and targeting people is very important because they need to show how is the country is very weak and mm-hmm. they are very strong.
Mm-hmm. Do you see any link of the timing of such an accident with efforts by the Iraqi military to recapture Mosul from the Daesh militants?
Exactly. Mm. Yeah, of course, they need to attract the tension between Daesh and Mosul to other area just to distract the government from doing anything.
Mm-hmm. Right. Let's go to the New York Times, and the headline reads: Brussels attack Belgian police arrest six people after suicide bombings. Now, police in Brussels have made six arrests following Tuesday's airport and metro suicide bombings after a day in which two Belgian government ministers offered to resign amid mounting criticism of the country's failure to foil the attacks, with prosecutors releasing more evidence that the attacks were carried out by the same Daesh network responsible for November's carnage in Paris, and two suspects still believed to be on the run. Several police raids were carried out across Brussels on Thursday evening. The operation involved SWAT teams and armored cars with helicopter support, began after 9 p.m. And of course, police cited sources saying it had targeted people suspected of taking part in the attacks that killed at least 31 people and injured 300. Federal prosecutors confirmed six unidentified people were arrested, including three who were detained outside the prosecutor's own office in the center of Brussels. Two others were arrested in the Belgian capital, and one person was arrested on the city's outskirts. Special police units supported by the army also carried out separate raids in northeastern Brussels, where explosives were discovered in a separate operation in the immediate aftermath of the attacks. However, no arrests were confirmed in this raid. How do you view the efforts by the police and the raids and the arrests of six people after the attacks?
Yeah, I think one of the situations they have, what's happened, they link what is that, as you know, the last attacks group in the airport and in the outside in the metro stations with my two friends, and one of them is the brother of someone, and they link it, the other families, the other members, have, and I think the process is doing well, very well in finding the people and tracking the people to have them arrested. But they are very late. They are very late.
That's
because
the
they should understand how this group working. And they, you know, you can't blame them because a lot of people, this networking, you need to deal with people in Iraq, in Syria, before coming to Europe countries.
Indeed.
So it's very important, yeah.
Indeed, right. Major General Mahmoud Morsi, strategic researcher at Chatham House, London. I'd like to thank you very much, sir, for joining us this afternoon.
You are welcome.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
With that, ladies and gentlemen, we wrap up our edition of The World Today. Many thanks for joining us.